1970s, and they actually ran. I never knew that. They ran in the magazine. And Larry Flint had posters made of us. Well, Jackie got her hands on one, and she actually signed the one that we found. It said, "To Andy, love Jackie." And there it was in the time capsule. We had a handwriting expert come in and look at the signature and look at the handwriting, and he verified that that was absolutely Jackie's real signature. So she actually had a sense of humor about it. But that was one of those great discoveries that you just, you know, pinch yourself like, is that really that? Just amazing. And just as he had all of these things in the time capsules, Andy's house was also just completely overrun. In 1971, he moved from the first townhouse to his second home, which was on 66th Street, between Park and Madison in New York. And that was a true mansion, a five-story townhouse, really, really luxe interior, and a huge home. 2 years ago, both of the houses were on the market, actually. The first one was on sale for $6 million, which isn't that bad for a four-story townhouse in New York City that Andy Warhol used to live in. But the second townhouse was on the market for $38 million. That's how grand it was. But even though it was grand, it was also filled to the rafters with stuff. Andy, because he was making more and more money as his career went on, would, instead of spending maybe $200 on a chair at an antique store, all of a sudden he had enough funds to go to Christie's and buy a really important piece of American furniture for $40,000. He bought a console once for $80,000. It was shipped to the house in a crate and never taken out of the crate. It went up against the wall and there it sat. And that's how the house really was. This week, I think on Thursday, when I'm in the city for the Armory Show, I'm meeting the photographer who was hired by Fred Hughes, who's Andy's business manager, to go into the house and record every room and every object as it was 2 days after Andy died in 1987. So I'm really looking forward to seeing these pictures of the house as it was, and the images that he's sent to me so far are just crates stacked everywhere, the dining room table completely covered with shopping bags, and then there'd be a Jasper Johns painting on the wall, or a Rauschenberg, or a Kenny Sharp sculpture. All of this stuff just cohabitated within the space. When they went into the house after Andy died to catalog, they actually found fake drawers and filing cabinets with cash and jewels hiding. Andy had a big four-poster bed in his bedroom, drapes and curtains. There is money and diamonds and jewels hiding up inside all the folds. So he was definitely a child of the Great Depression, a Depression era child who just always hoarded. So there was always be something they would fall back on, just in case. This picture, which is from 1965, is very representative of Andy at the time, and is taken inside his famous silver factory. And this also shows how the idea of production really played out in Andy's life. He really replicated the idea of all of those factories back home in Pittsburgh by covering the walls and the floor and the ceiling and the pipes and the columns with either aluminum foil or silver paint. Every surface within the first factory was completely covered with silver. And it was not only his art studio, and you can see him here sitting on one of his famous Brillo boxes, which he actually made in the upstairs guest bedroom of his townhouse. And he's holding a squeegee, which would have been his main tool. So instead of a paintbrush, he's using a squeegee to apply the paint to the canvas. And that in and of itself, we could go into a two-hour lecture about hand painting versus pushing ink through a silkscreen. But in addition to it being a studio, Andy Warhol's factory became the place to be seen and to see. He had parties quite often. Everyone from early on, Bob Dylan, who actually bought one of the Elvis paintings, and I'm sure many of you have heard the story that he actually traded his Elvis painting for a sofa. Must have been a really nice sofa, and I'm sure he's still kicking himself to this day. But anybody who was anybody wanted to go and see Andy Warhol and to be at a party in his factory. So later on, Mick Jagger, David Bowie, the any of these super celebrities came to New York and they were a little bit underground themselves, they wanted to go and hang out at the Silver Factory. And a lot of weirdos and eccentrics wanted to go out there as well. And Andy actually really, really enjoyed that. He was a voyeur, really, really grand scale. And he loved to watch drama unfold as though it was a film happening right in front of him. Around this time, Andy also started to produce films. Chelsea Girls, his experimental films, Empire, Sleep, Kiss. If you watch Chelsea Girls, you get the flavor of the craziness that would have happened at the factory. And even though many people think that Andy was a drug addict or an alcoholic and had to be high all the time, he hardly ever was. He took prescription pills, energy pills, and that's all he ever took. However, he really encouraged other people around him to take drugs. So amphetamines, all sorts of uppers and downers, and cocaine, and heroin, and all those sorts of things. He didn't care at all if you were doing that in the factory, because when you did that, you became somebody else, and you became theatrical. And he loved to just sit there on the sidelines and watch. And that was what Andy was very much about. Never being a true active participant, but always observing, monitoring, and watching. This summer, well actually not even this summer, in a few weeks, March 27th, we're opening a show called I Want to Watch at the Warhol Museum, which is a permanent installation on my sixth floor of all of Andy's films and videos that he made over the course of his lifetime. Thousands and thousands of hours of film. Andy really was one of the first avant-garde filmmakers going here in America. It's not an underlooked or understudied aspect of him, so we decided to dedicate an entire floor of our museum to that very, very important work. Well, one of the other eccentrics who came to the factory was Valerie Solanas. Many of you know that Andy Warhol was shot in 1968. Valerie was a fan and a playwriter, and she insisted that Andy would love the script that she'd written. She was the founding member, the sole member, of a group that she created called SCUM. I'm sure some of you have seen the SCUM manifesto. SCUM stood for the Society for Cutting Up Men, because she thought that the world would be a much better place without men, and that it should be an all-female, self-sustaining environment. And that's what the play was about.